السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, all his companions, his entire household. We ask Allah to bless them and to bless every single one of us. Brothers and sisters, this is the second last episode from the Pearls of Peace. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us inner and outer peace in the dunya as well as in the akhirah. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those not only who have heard what was said, but who can begin implementing it in our lives as much as we can. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us growth spiritually and to help us distance ourselves from shaitan. May Allah protect us all and our offspring. Ameen. Brothers and sisters, in Surah Al-Dhariyat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it very clear why He created us. Someone might ask, why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala create us? The answer may be in order to test us. Yes, that is part of the answer. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created death and life in order for us to be tested. So, who has better deeds from amongst us, he will be the one who will win. And the one whose deeds are not better shall be behind. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. May Allah grant us the ability to be from amongst those who can work on the deeds we engage in. The best of people are those who have better deeds. Sometimes people want to engage in a lot of deeds, but the quality of those deeds are not good. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns us. And in Surah Al-Dhariyat, He says very clearly, verse number 56 and 57, وَمَا فَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ I have not created mankind and jinnkind except for them to worship me. So we are to worship Allah alone. What this means is, He has made us in this world, or He has created us, brought us into existence in this world, so that we can lead this entire life in a way that will please Him. That is the meaning of the term worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes when this verse is read, some people think it means we engage in constant salah and we are standing, perhaps we are reading Quran constantly. The reality is, this is much broader than that understanding. It means everything you do in your life should not be against the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is what is meant. So if I am cautious and I try everything I do, I try to make sure that it is within the confines of what is permissible, that means I'm worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah make it easy for us. The way I dress, the way I talk, the way I walk, what I drink and eat, and everything else that I engage in, my dealings, the employment, everything else, I need to make sure it is within that which Allah has ordained. If I do that, it means I'm in constant worship of Allah. Even when I sleep, it will be considered the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if I do so in a place that I am permitted to do so, and in a position or in a manner that I am permitted to do so that will not earn the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May He grant us goodness. The same applies to our food and drink, as I've just mentioned. So Allah says, مَا أُرِيدُ مِنْهُمْ مِنْ رِزْقٍ وَمَا أُرِيدُ أَن يُطْعِمُونَ I don't want any sustenance from them, nor do I want to be fed from them. Allah does not want us to be, He does not want us to feed Him. Not at all. Allah is independent. But Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الرَّزَّاقُ ذُو الْقُوَّةِ الْمَتِينَ It is Allah who is the provider. And what this means is, if we think that through the disobedience of Allah, we will become wealthy or we will earn something to eat, Allah says, never ever. We are the ones who own sustenance. It is only through our pleasure that you will be able to earn correctly. May Allah grant us goodness. The owner of all the wealth that we are seeking, He is the one who will give it to us. How can we earn against the command of the one who owns our earning? Allahu Akbar. We won't be able to earn anything. And even if we achieve figures, we will not have any blessing. So Allah says, I know. If you want, ask me. If you want, worship me. If you would like, make sure you are heading in the right direction. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala soften our hearts. Some people, because they want to earn a little dollar or two, what happens? They begin to transgress, thinking, you know what, it's so hard to earn. The only way to earn is to do it this way, which is the wrong way. Allah is saying, hang on, you worship me, and I will ensure that your doors are open. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant it to us. And there is the flip side of the coin. What is that? Sometimes we see people who, mashallah, driving a beautiful car. Man has a big business. And shaitan comes to us and makes us say, oh, this guy is driving a big car. Perhaps he's peddling drugs. That's a thought that comes. Perhaps he's dealing in diamonds. Perhaps, why do we think someone is doing wrong when they have got, when Allah has provided them, they might have had the most upright dealings. Do not have a dirty mind that will result in the snatching away of your peace. When you see people living in a beautiful home, driving a lovely motor vehicle, thank Allah, they have worked very, very hard. Allah has provided them, mashallah. And we need to work as hard or even harder. But more important than working hard to achieve the vehicle or the house is to build the palace of the hereafter. And this will happen by earning the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whenever we see people suddenly becoming wealthy, never let shaitan come to your mind and think they've done something wrong to get there. No, they haven't. And even if in the rare case they have, it's between them and their maker. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Najm, which is a powerful surah, makes mention of the credibility of the statements of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The fact that whatever he utters is in fact from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Verse number 3 and 4. وَمَا يَنطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. Whatever he has uttered sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not from his own desires or whims and fancies. It is in fact revelation that was revealed to him. Inspiration that he was inspired with from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Today we have people who say, this is the Quran. I accept it, I adopt it. But as for the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I don't want to accept it because, you know, it's not necessary, or it was only registered so many hundred years down the line and so on. Wallahi, those people were predicted by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There will come a group of people who will say, this is the Quran, it's enough for us. And as for the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is something that we do not want. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us with the blessed lips of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَلَا إِنِّي أُوتِيتُ الْقُرْآنَ وَمِثْلَهُ مَعَهُ. Behold, I have been given the Quran and together with it something similar to it. And that is explained unanimously as the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His statements. Remember, if people were to tell you that the sunnah was only recorded 150 years to 200 years after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there will come a time when they will tell you the Quran was also registered 30, 40 years after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And people will start saying, why didn't they record it from day one? Today I want to provide you an answer that you can equip yourselves with. If someone came to you and said, why didn't Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam use CDs? We would laugh. Because the CD technology only came out now. If someone said, why didn't he have a laptop? We would laugh. Why didn't he put the Quran up on the internet? That is exactly the same statement as saying, why didn't they write it? Because they could not read or write. They all relied on their minds. That was the technology of the age. They knew the lineage of the camel 25 generations up. Allahu Akbar. You're trying to tell me they don't know the word of Allah? La ilaha illallah. Look at the fools of today who want to find discrepancy in the words of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They want to find discrepancy in the Quran. The fools holding PhDs will tell you, no, this was only 40 years later. Why didn't they register it? You're such a big fool, my brother. Sorry, I'm a bit emotional. The reason is, to be honest with you, my brothers and sisters, we need to realize Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam at his time, they relied on their memories. They had the most powerful memories ever. They could memorize thousands of couplets of poetry. We cannot memorize our own phone numbers to save our lives. Why? Because technology has overtaken. That's why. 20 years ago, I knew perhaps 80, 90 phone numbers off by heart. Today, how many of us can put up their hands and say, I know 100 phone numbers off by heart? Let's see. Not one. You see that? Subhanallah. Not one. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. And had someone put up their hand, I would have swapped with them and let them recite the numbers. My brothers and sisters, today if I can memorize the Quran, and from amongst us, please show us with a show of hands how many of you have memorized even a small portion of the Quran. Put up your hand. Let's see. Allahu Akbar. Lo and behold, it's a gift of Allah. Let's put our hands down. My brothers and sisters, this goes to show, if you have memorized parts of the Quran, you are trying to tell me the Sahaba radiallahu anhum did not know that? They did not memorize it? How foolish are those who say, why wasn't it written? Don't you know Allah says, هُوَ الَّذِي بَعَثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ Allah has sent amongst the unlettered a messenger from them. They were unlettered, he was unlettered. The bulk of them, very few of them could read or write. But they relied on their memories. So the technology of writing came later on. As soon as it came, they began to write. So as soon as the CDs came, we put it on. As soon as the internet came, it's on. As soon as the little microchips came, it's on. iPhone and everything else is on. And even Wi-Phone, mashallah, it's on by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. I hope we understand. It's a clarification that really needed to have come a long, long time ago. Foolish! Wallahi, the biggest fools are those who want to say, why was it written 200 years later? Go to sleep, my brother. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. We need to wake up from the oblivion that we are in. Wallahi, I am very emotional about this, because how can we find fault in the best of creation? How can we find fault in the word of Allah when we have memorized it? I saw perhaps 1,000 hands just now, didn't I? You saw them. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum had memories far more powerful than mine and yours. Let's continue. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us and grant us peace. Like I say, we will only achieve peace when we understand that this is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No book in history has ever come down through so many generations without a spot of change. Not even a droplet. Not a single book. Even the ones that are authored by people of today, as it comes down, you find a few discrepancies. With the Quran, not one. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us and grant us ease. When we believe that there is no doubt in the book, we achieve a lot of peace, because when we read it, we know it is the word of the Almighty, the Creator, the one who made me, the one whom I'm going to return to. This is His word. This is how I will achieve salvation. And that word of Allah leads me to the words of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that is what I will believe in. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. In Surah Al-Hadid, which is one of the surahs we read, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us something very important again. Every one of us, we've heard so many messages. We've had messengers come to us, recite the verses, remind us. We've had reminders either from the radio or the CDs or whatever else, a book we read, whatever it was. Someone told us something. Allah asks a question. Verse number 16 of Surah Al-Hadid. أَلَمْ يَأْنِ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَن تَخْشَعَ قُلُوبُهُمْ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَمَا نَزَلَ مِنَ الْحَقِّ Has the time now not come for those who believe, for their hearts to become humbly submissive to the remembrance of Allah and what we have revealed in terms of the truth? Has that time not come? What are you waiting for? Why are you not turning? What is it that you are waiting? Do you want punishment to come to you before you turn? You've had a reminder, two reminders. You've seen the examples of those before you. You've seen everything happening, people dying. You've seen people coming to life. You've seen those dying at a young age, those dying later on. You've seen absolutely everything. أَلَمْ يَأْنِ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَن تَخْشَعَ قُلُوبُهُمْ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ Has the time not come for those who claim to believe to soften their hearts and to adopt what Allah has revealed? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala soften our hearts towards His remembrance and towards that which He has revealed. Brothers and sisters, these reminders will not continue. As I said, we have a quota of them. When our quota is over, we will be overtaken by something which will be unpleasant. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not let us see that day. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really calls us towards tawbah, towards repentance. And He says, you want to compete with one another. Do you know what we do? We compete with one another in this world. Regarding what? Brother, he's earned 20, I need to earn 30. Now he's earned 30, I need to earn 40. He's driving a Ferrari, I need to go to Harare. Subhanallah. Allah protect us. You know what I mean? He's driving a nice car, I want to drive a better vehicle. Subhanallah. This is happening. He's got this type of clothing, I need something better. He's got this, I need that. And this is the competition. So Allah tells us, verse number 20, He says, اِعْلَمُوا, you need to know, أَنَّمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا, that the life of this dunya, لَعِبٌ وَلَهْوٌ وَزِينَةٌ, it is a play, a pastime, and a beautification. وَتَفَاخُرٌ بَيْنَكُمْ, and a competition between you. وَتَكَاثُرٌ فِي الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَوْلَادِ, and the multiplication of your wealth and your children. So people are born, they play with simple toys. After a while, they are amused by more sophisticated toys. And after a while, they start competing with one another. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. In fact, the term beautification is made mention of, because a little child is not too bothered as to what they look like. Look at the teenagers. Small little squiggle on their face and they won't even go to school. Dad, I can't go. Why? Can't you see this pimple on my face? Allahu Akbar. That is, they are conscious of it. They become conscious of the beauty and they want the nice things in the world. Allah says, that's the dunya. The dunya, that's its nature. As you grow, it's a playtime. It's an amusement. As you grow further, you find a beautification. Then you get married. When you get married, now mashallah, you're happy for a while. And thereafter, inshallah, you want to have children. And subhanallah, then you want to multiply your wealth. And you say, you know what, we're earning for our children. That's what you're saying. Brother, earn for yourself the paradise. Allahu Akbar. What's the point of setting your generations, three generations down? You're worth so many million, but you don't even have a little small corner in your own grave. Allahu Akbar. May Allah grant us the understanding, common logic. And that you earn by struggling or striving to obey Allah's instruction. You want to go to work from 8 to 5? Well, go to Allah at least for 24 minutes in the 24 hours. Allahu Akbar. And you will achieve a lot. You'll be able to not only build your little spot in your grave, but you'll be able to have a huge castle in the life after. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. A sacrifice is required. Without the sacrifice, we won't achieve. So Allah says, كَمَثَلِ غَيْثٍ أَعْجَبَ الْكُفَّارَ نَبَاتُهُ. It is similar to the rain that has caused produce to grow, that made the farmer very happy because he saw, wow, look, I sowed the seed and now look at this green crop that is growing. In no time, ثُمَّ يَهِيجُ فَتَرَاهُ مُصْفَرًّا. He will find it wilting and becoming yellow. Any crop, you leave it without harvesting it at the correct time, it will start becoming yellow and it wilts. And after that, it is scattered in the form of seed. Allah says this. The same happens to you, O man. You need to understand you have energies. Use those energies whilst you have them, because there will come a time when you become yellow and you start wilting. Then you are scattered back into the ground. Allahu Akbar. This is Allah. So He says the competition should not be for wealth and for children. It should be. Verse number 21, سَابِقُوا إِلَىٰ مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا كَعْرْضِ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Compete or make haste or race towards the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the earning of paradise, which is wider than the width of the skies and the earth put together. May Allah grant us goodness. Are we ready for the race, inshallah? You see someone, mashallah, reading salah and you tell yourself and Allah, Ya Allah, I will read even a better salah. This is the way. Like we've said, when you see people spiritually higher than you, it should motivate you to go even higher. And when you are in terms of material wealth of this world, look at those below you, so it will make you appreciate the level you are upon. May Allah grant us peace. Now let's move further. There is a surah named after a woman who came to plead with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam regarding her husband. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala heard the statement. She was complaining. She was actually debating. She said, my husband does this and this and this and so on and so forth. Terrible things. And so Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was trying to calm her down and was trying to, you know, tell her, okay, we'll see what will happen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala heard this. Obviously He knows. But He revealed verses that we are reciting today. قَدْ سَمِعَ اللَّهُ قَوْلَ الَّتِي تُجَادِلُكَ فِي زَوْجِهَا وَتَشْتَكِي إِلَى اللَّهِ. Allah has heard the woman who is pleading with you regarding her husband and complaining to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And these verses And I invite you to read the meaning of these verses. They continue in Surah Al-Mujadila, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we heard, and the rulings thereafter, we are not going to go into them, but we want to draw a lesson. My brothers and sisters, let's address the brothers here. Sometimes you know, the way you speak to your spouse is so hurtful, but she has nowhere to go. Why? You married her. Perhaps she doesn't want to burden her parents with what you've done. And perhaps she has nowhere else to turn. And perhaps you are oppressing her by swearing her, by beating her up. May Allah protect us never to be like that. That is totally prohibited, my brothers and sisters. And perhaps we might be suffocating her, causing depression, perhaps driving her to suicidal thoughts. Allah knows. These verses are telling you, my brothers, that Allah has heard, He is watching, the complaint is received, and He will deal with you. May Allah safeguard us. Is it worth it? Make life easy for your spouses. May Allah protect us. Allah, why is this verse revealed? The first verse of Surah Al-Mujadila, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, we heard what she is saying, and we know she's complaining to us. Where else is she going to go? Allah says, here's the solution. And the solution, because of the statement that this man was uttering, and I can let you know what it was. Now that she was a little bit older, he did not want to fulfill her rights of intimacy. So he started telling her, you know what, you are just like my mother, man. Astaghfirullah. Which means, you are like haram on me. How can I even be intimate with you? And Allah says, you shall fulfill the rights of that spouse of yours. You cannot have just abused her. When she was young, you married her. Now that she's given birth to your children, you want to discard her and flick her off. You need to realize, all what she did was definitely because she was in your company and she did it for you after the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. You should appreciate the fact that they have grown older with you. You need to honor them and you need to respect them. Very soon we will die returning to Allah. Like we said, when we have lived our lives in the proper manner, we will enter paradise and we will be able to achieve the eternal peace. When we see our own spouses in paradise, we will be shocked as to the perfection of this particular person. Absolutely perfect. We will not want anyone besides them. Yet, if we were to tell you here, you're going to have the same husband. Oh, some of the sisters will say, oh, is there anywhere else I could go besides that paradise? May Allah protect us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness, really. It's about time we resolved our matters. Remember, if you are suffocating someone in silence and they cannot turn to anyone but Allah, Allah says, we will definitely get back to you. At some stage, somehow, we know how we are going to get back to you. You don't oppress my worshippers, who happen to be females, whom I know how close they are to me, how much they've sacrificed. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us and grant us goodness. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from being from amongst those whom this is happening to in reverse. Which means sometimes, and I see the brothers are looking at me so gloomy, and I see sometimes it might be happening the other way around, the same applies. Just remember that. I hope that particular little interjection would have helped us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. Then, you know, Allah makes mention of something very, very powerful also. Many times we have little meetings. You know, today I'm talking to you, it's public, mashallah. It's open for my brothers and sisters in Islam and even the non-Muslims. Perhaps we may have a few seated somewhere here. Remember one thing, my brothers and sisters, when we have meetings in closed doors or behind closed doors, what is the reason we are having those meetings? The Quran discusses this. Allah says in verse number 9 of the same surah, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, O you who believe, idha tanajaytum. When you have your little closed private meetings, فَلَا تَتَنَاجَوْا بِالْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدَوَانِ وَمَعْصِيَةِ الرَّسُولِ. Never ever be discussing sin, meaning how to engage in sin, or enmity, or transgression against the command of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When you have those closed private meetings, they should be تَنَاجَوْا بِالْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى. Righteousness and piety. Talk to people. You have a closed door meeting to solve problems. You have a closed door meeting to do something good. You have a closed door meeting to earn closeness to Allah. You never have a private meeting in order to plan how to transgress and how to do the wrong things. May Allah protect us. This is how deep the Quran goes. And this is peace. This is when we achieve peace. People want to call you to a private meeting. Tell them, what are you calling me for? Is it a good meeting where we are going to discuss some growth of the ummah? We are going to discuss some form of bringing us together? Or are we discussing how to separate and divide? If that's the case, I don't want to come. But if you are calling me for a good reason, I will be the first one there. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. Now mashallah, the other verse, verse number 11 of the same surah, it applies to us right here, right now. Subhanallah. You see how we are seated, mashallah? We are seated very close to each other. Sometimes a brother might want to walk out. You know, you have some people walking out maybe because they need the bathroom or something has happened or it's an emergency. It happens. Whenever you are told to make space, the Quran says, imagine how deep Allah goes. When you are seated in a gathering and you are told to make space, Allah will make space for you. That's what the Quran says. And when you are told to get up, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless you. Subhanallah. Imagine how deep the teachings are. Today we feel bad. Subhanallah. I am not saying intentionally walk through the people. Subhanallah. You know, someone sent me a WhatsApp little clip. I'm sure it might have done its rounds here. Where they say there were people sitting in Jum'ah. You see it. And one man, he crossed. He moved the shoulders and he went forth. So these three youngsters were sitting in the first saf, or the second saf, they were disturbed. And the imam is speaking. And then someone else crossed. And they were disturbed again. And when the third man crossed, they just caught him, threw him down and started beating him up. To say, hey, don't you know, don't disturb us. Obviously, that is foolish. But at the same time, the lesson drawn from it is powerful. You do not unnecessarily tap shoulders and walk forward. If there is a necessity, maybe you may do so. But if it's not necessary, do not disturb people. On top of that, remember when you enter the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, try and sit in a way that you are filling from the beginning, from the front. Because if I see a gap right in the front and you haven't filled it, it's my right to tap you on the shoulders and go in front because you haven't filled the saf. So people sometimes get upset to say, why are you crossing here? Why don't you think and wait back, you know? But brother, you left a gap in the front. Is it? It's not my fault. You want the devil to sit there. I'd rather sit there. And I'm not a devil. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us protection. May Allah open our doors. So Allah says, إِذَا قِيلَ لَكُمْ تَفَسَّحُوا فِي الْمَجَالِسِ فَفْسَحُوا يَفْسَحِ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. When you are told to make space in a gathering, make space, Allah will make space for you. Amazing. Verse number 11, perhaps we should go home and read that verse by the will of Allah. You will be surprised as to the depth with which the Quran has discussed these matters that affect us on a daily basis. Let's take a look at Surah Al-Hashr. Surah Al-Hashr, I want to raise one point. Allah makes mention of the Muhajireen, those people who were basically driven out of Makkah al-Mukarramah and they made the migration to Medina. They were known as Muhajireen. But Allah also makes mention of the Ansar and Allah calls them the successful. Why were the Ansar successful? Because they had some qualities in them. Those qualities brought about peace, harmony and tranquility across the ummah at a time when really it would not have been achieved unless these qualities were there coupled with the consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So look at what Allah says. وَالَّذِينَ تَبَوَّأُوا الدَّارَ وَالْإِيمَانَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ يُحِبُّونَ مَنْ هَاجَرَ إِلَيْهِمْ وَلَا يَجِدُونَ فِي صُدُورِهِمْ حَاجَةً مِمَّا أُوتُوا وَيُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ وَلَوْ كَانَ بِهِمْ خَصَاصَةٌ وَمَنْ يُوقَ شُحَّ نَفْسِهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. Allah describes those Ansar who opened up their houses to the ones who migrated to them. They opened up their houses, they loved them, and they did not find in their hearts any form of negativity towards them, or they gave whatever they needed with an open heart, in the way, or in a manner that even if they needed something desperately, the fact that they needed it more than us, it was given. Allahu Akbar. Imagine this means, or this in the Arabic language is called al-ithar. Yu'thiruna ala anfusihim. To give preference to others over yourself. We are losing this in the ummah today. Today, even if it's just a seat, we'll say, no, let me choose the best spot. But there is an elderly uncle behind, so what? You should have come early. That's the attitude today. No.
Give preference to them over yourself. If you are squashed up a little bit, Allah will open your doors because you opened the door for someone else. Give preference to someone. May Allah protect us. Today we are really suffocating because a lot of us are guilty of the opposite, where we want the good things for ourselves. You know, you see a plate of samosas and you go for the biggest one. Allah protect us. You can see it's Ramadan, can't you? So my brothers and sisters, this is something we need to know. Do not want everything nice only for yourself. Learn to share things. Allah says, whosoever can save themselves from the greed of their own selves is the one who's successful. When you can protect yourself from your own greed, then you are successful. So you need to consider. You need to give preference to others as well. Yes, at times it might come that, mashallah, you have something and perhaps, you know, the others are not competing for it, or maybe rightfully it's yours, you've worked for it and so on. We are not saying it's not rightfully yours. Perhaps it is, but consider what Allah is saying. If that thing is drawing you away from your brothers and sisters in Islam, give it away. Really. If something is creating a distance between you and your fellow brothers and sisters, you need to give that away. It's not healthy for you. It's not good for your spirituality. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. So Allah describes the Ansar and praises them because of these conditions that they had, or these qualities that they had within them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. Now in Surah Al-Mumtahina, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says something very, very important. Today we say, you know, I hate this person. That's what we say. I hate them. And when we hate people, we've got no moderation in our hatred. We hate them completely and we say bad things and we go around doing whatever we have to bring them down because of the hatred, without realizing that Allah can create a day when you two will be the best friends. Allah can do that. And sometimes you love someone so much that you drop your guard, so they know all your secrets, to the degree that the day something happens between the two of you, you are enslaved by the fact that they know more about you than anyone else. So Allah is warning us about this. Imagine how powerful it is. You want to have peace, your enmity needs to be in moderation, because that person can become your friend. And your love for someone, you need to realize tomorrow it can change. Do you know? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us moderation. The only one who will not let you down is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's a guarantee. He will not let you down. So Allah says, verse number 7, Surah Al-Mumtahina.
عَسَى اللَّهُ أَن يَجْعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ وَبَيْنَ الَّذِينَ عَادَيْتُمْ مِنْهُمْ مَوَدَّةً.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can create between you and those who are your enemies love. Did you hear that? Allah can create between you and those who are your enemies love. Wallahu qadir, Allah is all able. Wallahu ghafurur rahim, Allah is most forgiving, most merciful. And this is what happened at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. To be honest with you, some of those who had caused a lot of harm to Islam, when they uttered the shahada, they were embraced, they became brothers. They were most loved, they became relatives as well. There was marriage between them. It can happen. So remember, do not hate without a limit. In fact, with us, let's use the word dislike. The word hate is a little bit heavy, especially in today's world. We say dislike. It serves the same purpose, but it has a meaning that is more palatable. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an understanding. So you dislike someone, remember, deep down, this person, Allah can turn their heart. Something can happen that can make us related. Relation of the highest degree. Allahu Akbar. Imagine your daughter gets married to their son. Allahu Akbar. May Allah open up the doors. Allahu Akbar. Really, so this is why we say, when you love someone, my brothers and sisters, you love in moderation. Meaning, mashallah, you fulfill everything that you have to. Especially if it's a spouse, but we're talking here of perhaps a friend, an acquaintance and so on. Certain things you need to know, this is the limit. Beyond that, if you lower your guard, there may come a day when you regret it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. Inshallah, tomorrow will be the last episode of this particular series. We ask Allah to grant us goodness and ease, to accept it from us. And until inshallah we meet again there, we say wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallah bihamdihi, subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayka.